is it since the last Tears for Fears record?
Meaning albums? Well, by the time this one comes out, it will be 4.5 years.
That is staggering, isn't
it?
Yeah,
it's a long time. Long time to try and make a record in.
So, what's the story?
Well, I mean, we haven't been making a record all that time. We were touring for a year after the last album came out, and we didn't start touring straight away, so that took, you know, just over a year to finish promoting that album. And then we were so tired, we decided to take some time off and just to be able to step away from the industry and not have to think about it for a while. So we did that and did some writing. That took up another year, just relaxing and writing. And then the start of 87, we went into the studio for the first time with a producer. And that went on for 10 months, which is a long time, until myself and Roland realized that it really wasn't going that well and it wasn't what we wanted to do. It wasn't new enough. It wasn't breaking any new grounds. It was becoming quite similar to the album before. So we decided that we wanted to do it ourselves. So we scrapped that and again took a couple of months off to think about exactly what we wanted to do. It wasn't until January 88 we started recording. So it's only really taken us a year and a half, but because of the false start and because of all the work we did after the last album and the fact we needed a rest, it's been 4.5 years. Seeds as a first single being so Beatlesque is quite a strange thing for us to release, but I don't mind that, you know, it makes it exciting again. I prefer people to listen to it and go, wow, this is Tears for Fears, it's a bit different. I mean, that's a much better reaction than, yeah, sounds like Tears for Fears, you know, sounds like the last record. It definitely was done. It was sort of, you do sit down. We had the title basically called Sowing the Seeds of Love before the song was written. In fact, it was Mr. England sowing the seeds of love. And we had that idea. We had an idea of I Love a Sunflower, which they sort of joined together because it's a bit of graffiti on a wall outside Roland's house. And it was just the whole sentiment of those two phrases was very much a 60s sentiment. So that in that way, it was intentionally a 60s song. And the Beatles being the thing you think about as a 60s group, it was done as a Beatles pastiche. We did try and create an I Am the Walrus combined with All You Need Is Love kind of song. And so it was intentional. And when we recorded it, we thought, well, should we try and record it, you know, a 1988 version of it? Or do we record it the way it was intended, i.e. record it the same way, make it sound like the Beatles? You know, what the hell? It's a more honest way of doing it. So we did it that way.
Yeah. If you're a Warren man,
the last album I actually bought a house. I spent a lot of time, you know, trying to renovate that because it was an old wreck. So that's really what I did after the last record. And then in between times I was helping a friend of mine with his music. He's a musician and he was doing demos, and I'd be sitting with him and doing just, you know, just enjoying myself as a musician outside of Tears for Fears, because it was nothing that was, not that it wasn't important, but it was nothing that was precious to me. So I had fun just helping someone else. Those kind of things, and the fact that it allows you the freedom to travel, to go and see places that you would like to see. Yeah, that's the sort of thing I did.